I made this video in 2022, all about plantar fasciitis and the best available treatment options according to the research at the time. It was one of the first videos I made when I set up this channel, and it's had a lot of really positive feedback, which I'm very grateful for. And one of the most common questions that I get asked in the comments is whether anything new has come to light since that video. And the answer is yes, there have been some new treatments and some new clinical studies, and as a result my practice has changed a little to the degree that I thought it'd be worth doing an update video. So if you've not seen any of my content before, I'm Stephen Bunting and I'm a specialist MSK physiotherapist working in the UK. Welcome to my channel, where I discuss the common MSK problems that affect everyday people and the evidence-based treatments that can help. So like I said, I've covered plantar fasciitis in detail in this video, and in it I discuss exactly what the condition is, how it's diagnosed, what causes it, and what the evidence-based treatments were according to a large, high-quality study in 2021. So in this video, I'm not going to repeat myself. If you want that information, then do go and watch it and then come back, because in this video, I'll just be sharing what new information has emerged since then and how my practice has changed as a result. So in my last video, I discussed a few of the interventional treatments being used at the time. So I talked about cortisone injections, shockwave therapy, dry needling or needle fenestration, and platelet-rich plasma injections. I also talked about all of the evidence-based self-help treatments, including load management, weight loss, footwear and orthotics such as heel cushions and insoles, taping, and exercises. Now, there hasn't been much new evidence for the self-help treatments, but there have been some new interventional treatments that have become available and some changes in practice regarding some of the older treatments. So the publication of this paper in the Journal of Medical Ultrasound in 2023 has collated much of the current evidence behind most of the interventional treatments available for plantar fasciitis, including the newer treatments that I'll be talking about in this video. I'll put a link to the full article in the description if you want to read it, as well as all the other studies that I'll be referring to in this video. The article collates the current evidence for the established interventional treatments, which I'll quickly summarise. So for shockwave therapy, there is good evidence that it can help with pain relief for up to 4 months after treatment, but it doesn't seem to be helping much beyond that. For cortisone injections, it's a similar story. Good pain relief for up to about 3 months, but there are potential risks and side effects with cortisone, which are increased with repeated injections. But more about cortisone injections later. For PRP injections, they seem to show better results than cortisone over the longer term, with effective pain relief being reported up to about 12 months after the procedure, and without the side effects of cortisone. Okay, so the first of the new treatments that have emerged in recent years are Botox injections. Botox, or to be correct, botulinum toxin, is a treatment used to cause temporary muscle paralysis. It's been used very effectively over the last 2 decades to reduce muscle tension and painful spasms in a number of different neurological conditions. And it's also become hugely popular in the cosmetic industry for reducing the fine lines and facial wrinkles associated with aging. In plantar fasciitis, botulinum toxin A is injected into the small muscles of the foot near the heel. And once these muscles are paralysed, it seems to help reduce pain within the plantar fascia, although we're not sure exactly how it does this. A handful of clinical trials have now been done which seem to show promising results. This review study, published in 2021, summarised the findings of all the research to date and found that Botox offered significant pain relief up to 12 months after the procedure. So while this treatment is still in its infancy, it does seem to have potential, so it's definitely one to watch. Okay, so next up is radiofrequency nerve ablation. This is a treatment that involves using a specialised needle that can heat up to a high temperature and essentially burn away the small nerves responsible for generating pain. It's another one of those treatments that have been around for a while now to treat other painful conditions, particularly some types of spinal pain. But it's only recently started to be used for plantar fasciitis. A handful of clinical studies have now been done, including this one in 2022, which looked at 378 feet and found positive results in pain relief for an average of 15 months after radiofrequency treatment. But pain relief wasn't instant, and indeed there was no improvement noted 1 month after treatment, so it would seem that its effect is a slow burn, so to speak. And the last of these newer treatments I'm going to discuss is dextrose prolotherapy. This is another treatment similar to PRP, shockwave and dry needling, whereby you're trying to provoke the plantar fascia by irritating it in a controlled way in order to try and stimulate a healing response. With dextrose prolotherapy, you inject an irritant sugar solution into the plantar fascia. A review paper in 2022 looked at the results of 6 previous clinical studies and summarised that this treatment offered pain relief for up to 6 months, but overall it was no more effective than shockwave therapy. And that's really the last of the newer treatments. There are also some other treatments currently being looked at, including transcatheter arterial embolisation and something called softwave therapy, which is a lower energy, less aggressive and less painful form of shockwave therapy. But there haven't been any good studies to support these novel treatments just yet, so it's a case of just watching this space. Cortisone injections for plantar fasciitis have had a bit of a roller coaster reputation. They used to be done very frequently, but then about 15 years ago, researchers raised concerns that they could potentially weaken the collagen fibres of the plantar fascia, increasing the risk of recurrence. Because of this, and the fact that the injections were very painful, often fairly ineffective, and only provided short-term pain relief, I largely stopped offering them in my practice. However, more recent studies have changed the conversation. The risks associated with cortisone appear to be more linked to repeated injections rather than a single, carefully administered dose. Current thinking is that ultrasound-guided cortisone injections produce significantly better results, and the guided technique also makes the procedure much less painful. The difference comes down to precision. Targeting the injection correctly under imaging guidance seems to make all the difference. So with this in mind, I've reintroduced cortisone injections into my practice over the last few years, but with strict criteria. I offer just one ultrasound-guided injection, and only after patients have tried all the standard self-care treatments, and only if their pain is intrusive and persistent, typically lasting at least 6 months. If the injection doesn't work or provides only temporary relief, then I won't repeat it. That said, I've seen far better long-term results with this approach, making me much more confident in recommending it when appropriate. Okay, so that's about it. There remains no good evidence to support the use of therapeutic ultrasound, laser or red light therapy, or the use of TENS machines, except for perhaps providing very short-term and temporary pain relief. Also, and I've said this before, but please steer clear of all the silly clickbait videos and articles that seem to be everywhere, claiming to cure plantar fasciitis instantly, or wanting to sell you some cream or supplement or device that seems too good to be true, because it will almost certainly be quackery. These fraudsters are just taking advantage of vulnerable and often desperate people, and their only interest is getting your click or your money. Okay, well, enough ranting. I do hope this video has been of some value to you. Good luck with your recovery, and please do check out my other video if you've not done so already. So until next time, take care and bye for now.